In the vast, churning Pacific theater of World War II, a ship's worth was measured by its guns and its sheer size. Battleships, aircraft carriers, fleet destroyers. These were the giants that dominated the seas. But in May 1944, a quiet, unheralded ship, a mere destroyer escort, barely half the length of a true destroyer, was about to challenge all those assumptions. This ship was the USS England, hull number DE635. Over a tense 12-day period, she would achieve a record that stands unbroken to this day, annihilating 6 Japanese submarines. That's roughly 1 submarine every 2 days, an unprecedented rate of destruction that utterly baffled the Japanese Imperial Navy. The Japanese Navy never figured out what was killing their crews so quickly. They knew only that their boats were dying instantly, shattered by unseen explosions that gave no warning. Yet this legendary achievement wasn't a stroke of blind luck. It was a cold, hard, logical victory. The engine of this triumph wasn't brute force, but a profound and almost solitary reliance on mathematics and a piece of technology most U.S. Navy captains simply refused to trust. This is the story of how a small ship using a forgotten weapon changed the entire way the war was fought at sea. On May 19th, 1944, the England's commanding officer, Lieutenant Commander Walton Pendleton, a man in his mid-40s, had a career with 0 confirmed submarine kills, but he possessed a quiet, almost stubborn trust in the data. He knew that the traditional anti-submarine weapon, the depth charge, was a statistical nightmare. Depth charges worked by guessing a submarine's depth, setting a hydrostatic fuse, and rolling the charge off the stern. The problem? The submarine had usually moved by the time the charge sank to its preset depth. The combat statistics were brutal and unforgiving. Across the entire war, British forces recorded only 1 confirmed kill for every 60 depth charge attacks. That is a dismal 1.65% success rate. And even when they missed, the massive explosion would cloud the water for a critical 15 minutes, blinding the sonar and allowing the submarine commander to slink away in the ensuing chaos. Therefore, any change to that old way of doing things was worth the risk. The England was equipped with a new experimental weapon called Hedgehog. This wasn't some complex new torpedo. It was a simple, forward-throwing mortar mounted on the ship's foredeck. It fired 24 projectiles in a circular pattern 200 yards ahead of the ship, but the genius was in the contact fuses. They only exploded if they struck something solid, the submarine's hull. This design had 3 immediate, stunning advantages that Pendleton understood before most other officers. First, a miss meant silence. No water disturbance to interrupt the sonar operator's tracking, so contact with the target was never lost. Second, the forward-throwing design meant you could maintain sonar contact right up until the point of impact. Third, and this is what mattered to Pendleton's logical mind, early trials, even with unpracticed crews, showed a roughly 5 to 8% success rate. That was 3 to 5 times better than the old depth charges. If you're a man who values facts over feel, you can appreciate why this new math spoke to Pendleton. The immediate target was the Japanese submarine I-16, whose secret communications the U.S. Navy's intelligence unit, Fleet Radio Unit Pacific, had already decoded. Pendleton, alongside 2 sister ships, was waiting for her. When the sonar operator called out the track, I-16 was diving, twisting, and turning. Standard evasion tactics from a skilled commander. The first 4 Hedgehog attacks missed. The complex, unpredictable movements of the sub, combined with the 9-second flight and descent time of the mortar projectiles, made calculating the point of impact a brutal challenge. I-16 had even gone deeper than anticipated, sinking to 325 feet. But Pendleton was an analytical hunter. He relied on his team's precision. On the 5th attack, the sonar data finally paid off. 4, then 6 detonations ripped through the deep. The pressure wave was so violent it physically lifted the England's stern clear of the water and knocked sailors off their feet. I-16 and her 107-man crew were gone. This first kill was just the beginning. The next challenge was much bigger. Fleet Radio Unit Pacific had decoded another transmission detailing a line of 7 Type RO Japanese submarines forming a scouting picket line. designated NA, stretching north of the Admiralty Islands. Their mission was to detect and report any American carrier task forces moving towards the Marianas. The success of the U.S. Pacific strategy relied on removing these eyes. Commander Hamilton Haynes, receiving this intelligence, knew he was sending three small destroyer escorts, England, George, and Raby, against seven formidable targets. But after the R-16 engagement, Pendleton had something new to offer. A proven success rate. In that initial fight, five Hedgehog attacks had secured one kill, a 20% success rate. For the crew, seeing the oil, the wood, and the body's surface was an undeniable, tangible proof that the weapon worked. They were converted. The hunter-killer group set out on May 21st. They couldn't rely on decoded messages anymore, as the Japanese were maintaining strict radio silence. Therefore, the Americans had to revert to the old way of detection. But even in the old way, Pendleton found an advantage. He knew the Japanese were predictable, positioning their subs along routes Admiral Halsey's forces had previously used. More critically, submarine patrol patterns were dictated by necessity. Surface at night to recharge batteries. Dive at dawn and run submerged during the day. This created a narrow, vulnerable window for radar detection. The enemy could crash dive and disappear in a mere 3 minutes, so speed was everything. The England's crew had drilled this sequence into a fine, deadly art. Sonar operators could track a diving sub, calculate its speed and depth, and predict its final position. The Hedgehog launcher could be reloaded and fired in 90 seconds. That meant a 24 projectile attack, where success or failure was immediately known by the sound of contact fuses, could end a mission and the lives of 56 men in just 9 seconds. On May 22nd, George's radar found the first sub, RO-106, on the surface, recharging her batteries. The sub crash-dived immediately, but George's Hedgehog attack missed. It was England's turn. The Japanese commander was experienced, making radical turns and changing depth constantly to force the Americans to guess his position. Pendleton didn't guess. The sonar data was fed directly into the Hedgehog firing solution. The first attack missed, proving the Japanese commander's skill at evading the 9-second projectile sink time. But on the second attempt, at 0501, three detonations, then a massive underwater explosion, rattled the three escort ships. The resulting oil slick was half a mile wide. Kill number 2, 3 days after I-16. If you are finding this story of precision, audacity, and success captivating, consider subscribing. On May 23rd, the hunt for RO-104 began. The commander of this sub had clearly learned from the fate of RO-106. He was running deep to evade detection and force the Americans to make a depth guess. Raby and George fired 4 attacks each, all missing. The sub commander was masterful, consistently turning inside the circular pattern of projectiles to render the attack impossible. But Division Commander Haynes, watching from the George, knew who the killer in the group was. England had 2 kills. The others had none. He sent a fateful 5-word message that would become Navy legend. Oh hell, go ahead, England. Pendleton's first attack missed, but his second attack at 0834 scored 10, maybe 12, detonations. The explosions merged into a single, continuous roar, followed by the sound of tearing metal and collapsing bulkheads. The submarine's batteries had ruptured. Kill number 3. 3 submarines in 72 hours. The next victim, RO-116, was detected by George's radar on the surface in the early morning of May 24th. The pattern of radar detection, crash dive and sonar tracking was repeating, but the RO-116 commander made a bold tactical change. He went shallow, to 150 feet. Most subs went deep, seeking a cushion of water against explosions. The RO-116 commander gambled that the Americans would set their Hedgehog solution for a deep diving target. He bet wrong. Pendleton's sonar operator instantly called out the shallow depth, and the firing solution was adjusted. The first attack at 0214 produced 3 to 5 detonations. It wasn't the massive explosion of the previous kills. It was the sound of 65-pound projectiles, traveling 723 feet per second, punching 3-inch holes in the sub's pressure hull. At that shallow depth, water would flood the hull at a terrifying 400 gallons per minute through a 3-inch hole. The submarine didn't immediately explode. It groaned. The weight of the water forced the sub deeper, increasing the pressure and the rate of flooding. Below 300 feet, the pressure sealed the crew's doom. The internal temperature soared, searing their lungs. Within 6 agonizing minutes, the crew was dead, and the sub continued its silent descent. Kill number 4. 4 submarines in 6 days. The news of the incredible killstreak reached the highest levels. Admiral Ernest King, the chief of naval operations in Washington, D.C., read the reports of one small destroyer escort sinking 4 submarines in 5 days using a weapon most captains distrusted. King's response was a simple, direct message to the Third Fleet. There'll always be an England in the United States Navy. The phrase spread like wildfire through the Pacific Fleet. The England was famous, but that fame brought unwanted attention. Admiral Halsey wanted to pull the England from submarine hunting to reassign her to carrier escort duty. She was deemed too valuable to risk, but Commander Haynes refused. 3 subs, RO-105, RO-108, and RO-109, remained on the NA line. England had a track record of 4 kills in 5 days, suggesting she could take out the remaining 3 in 3 more days. To pull her now would leave the mission incomplete, allowing the Japanese eyes to continue reporting fleet movements. Halsey reluctantly agreed to one more patrol. On the night of May 26th, the hunt for RO-108 began. The Japanese commander made the same tactical error as the last sub, staying shallow and making radical turns. But Pendleton's crew was now an elite, seasoned unit. They had tracked 4 submarines before this one and knew every evasion trick. Raby tried first and missed. Haynes's voice crackled over the radio again. "Go ahead, England." England commenced its attack on RO-108 at 23:23. 4, maybe 6 projectiles hit simultaneously, sounding like a single devastating blow. This time there was no slow flooding. The pressure hull ruptured instantly at multiple points. The submarine imploded. 56 men died in less than 3 seconds. Too fast to process what was happening. Kill number 5. 5 submarines in 8 days. In Tokyo, Admiral Soemu, Toyota, reviewed the patrol reports. 7 submarines deployed to the NA line, and 5 were now missing. No distress calls, just silence. The pattern was chillingly obvious. Something fast, something accurate, something unevadable was killing his submarines. Toyota issued new, desperate orders to the 2 remaining submarines, RO-105 and RO-109. New patrol depth, 400 feet minimum. New surface protocol, no battery recharging unless absolutely necessary. New evasion tactic, run silent at first detection, with no radical maneuvers because noise only gave the American sonar better tracking data. The Japanese were adapting, but they were learning from the mistakes of their dead comrades. The England, George, and Raby continued the hunt. They had the intelligence advantage, but the tactical situation was becoming complex. 5 kills had depleted the England's Hedgehog ammunition. They had only 120 rounds remaining, enough for 5, maybe 6 more attacks. On May 30th, the new Japanese tactics became clear. George's radar found RO-105, which immediately dove to 400 feet, then stopped all engines. Complete silence. No propeller noise, no machinery vibration. The contact signal was weak, intermittent, barely a knuckle, a patch of disturbed water that yielded false returns. Pendleton faced an impossible choice. Fire Hedgehog at a weak contact and likely miss, wasting 24 precious projectiles, or wait for the sub to move, conceding the tactical advantage. He chose to wait. 4 hours of agonizing silence passed. Finally, at 02:30 on May 31st, the signal strengthened. RO-105 was moving. Her batteries were running out. The commander had to surface soon or die. In a final desperate gamble, he surfaced at 03:15, but had drifted 3 miles with the current during the silent hours, putting him out of the hunting group's grid. He'd bought himself 90 seconds of charging time, enough to power his motors. England regained sonar contact at 0345. RO-105 was running deep and fast, 6 knots away from the escorts. This commander was good, perhaps the best they'd faced. He knew that depth and speed made the Hedgehog attack difficult. Pendleton's crew faced the mathematical nightmare. At 400 feet, the projectiles took 17 seconds to sink, and in that time, the sub could travel 170 feet, a wrong prediction, and the circular pattern would miss entirely. The first two attacks missed. The sub was varying her speed between 4 and 6 knots, making the calculation impossible. England had expended 48 projectiles in a matter of minutes. Only 72 remained. 3 chances to kill RO-105. Haynes watched, knowing this engagement was different. The previous 5 had died quickly. RO-105 was winning the math game, but at 0447, Pendleton's sonar operator detected a pattern. The Japanese commander, believing he was random, was turning 30 degrees to port, then 30 degrees to starboard, every 4 minutes. Humans aren't random, they fall into patterns. Pendleton adjusted the firing solution, predicting the next turn, leading the target by 200 feet. The third Hedgehog attack at 0508 was delivered perfectly. 4, maybe 5, detonations. The pressure hull was breached, but not destroyed. The sub was flooding, but still moving. The commander was blowing ballast tanks, executing emergency procedures to abandon ship and save his crew. But England's fourth and final attack at 0532 was the finishing blow. 8 detonations ripped the submarine apart. Emergency blow procedures ceased instantly. The crew never reached the surface. Oil and debris surfaced at 0615. Kill number 6. 6 submarines in 12 days. The record was unprecedented and impossible to believe. Halsey immediately pulled England from the hunt. 6 kills was enough. England had validated the Hedgehog system beyond any doubt. Every destroyer escort in the Pacific Fleet would receive new training, tactics, and firing solutions based on England's action reports. The remaining Japanese submarine, RO-109, took Toyota's warning to heart and was never found. She ran deep and silent, surviving the war. Her crew only learned months later that 6 of their sister submarines had been annihilated in 12 days by 1 small ship using a weapon they'd never heard of. The Presidential Unit Citation was awarded in July. It mentioned the crew's discipline and the weapon's effectiveness, but the citation didn't capture the real lesson. The mathematics did. England achieved a roughly 35 to 40% success rate, more than 20 times more effective than the old depth charges. Pendleton trusted numbers when other captains clung to tradition. He calculated and predicted while others guessed. After surviving a devastating kamikaze attack on May 9, 1945, off Okinawa, which killed 37 of her crew, the Navy repaired her but decommissioned her post-war as surplus. She was stripped for scrap, and by November 1946, the ship that sank 6 subs in 12 days was reduced to razor blades and tin cans. Her record remains. No ship has ever matched it. Lieutenant Commander Walton Pendleton survived the war. His grave at Arlington National Cemetery only mentioning the Navy Cross. It doesn't mention the 6 submarines or the 12 days that changed naval history forever. If this story reminds you of the quiet strength and intelligence that won the war, share this video because it helps us keep these memories alive for a new generation. If you have a story about a military relative's quiet act of heroism, let us know in the comments below.